Now we are shifting gears and going to look at children with solid tumors. So we again have very eminent faculty, Dr. Venkat, who is a pediatrician by MD training, and then he has done DM and is a professor in Cancer Institute now. He has a passion for pediatric oncology, and that you can see through his talk. And again, it's very important in one of the practicals, short notes can be kept, short notes will be there, and of course, one of the short cases can be there, and some of them will be tricky. So I'm sure he will be able to put some clarity into this sometimes difficult case scenarios. Venkat, please.
Thank you. Where do I stand? Is it visible now? Yeah. So very good morning to all of you. So for at least another few years, adult medical oncologists will have to see pediatric cases because there are very few pediatric oncologists in this country, and the curriculum is designed in such a way that you do, in some cases, at least 50% of your workload is pediatric oncology. So most of you, when you get trained, when you go out, you are very confident in at least seeing children above at least 2 to 3 years old. And you will get cases in the exam, as Dr. Rajiv said. You will get short notes, you will get your short case, and if you are very lucky, you might end up getting a long case, because sometimes examiners get excited. And a lot of the examiners themselves have good knowledge in pediatric oncology because over the years they got trained. So I'll go by the questions which are asked in the exam. So the first question is, you see a child, is what is the epidemiology of pediatric cancers? So pediatric cancers are not common. They are very rare. They account for less than 5% of all the cancers. Better have an idea of your what is the common cancers in your registry. In the world, approximately 2 lakh cancers are diagnosed every year. 80% in developing countries. So 20%, all the very high survival rates which you get are in the developed countries, but the survival rates are very poor in developing countries. And in India, we get about 30 to 40,000 cases a year, and in Tamil Nadu, about 2,000. We still don't have a pediatric tumor registry. The classification of pediatric tumors is not even very wide. Leukemias are clubbed together, AML and AL are clubbed together, lymphomas are clubbed together. So we really don't know what the real picture is. So this is another common question. You see that, you know, the survival for most of the cancers have improved anywhere from 20 to 50% to more than 90%. A common question asked is, what is the survival in stage 4 lung cancer? Many people say it's 40%, 50%. It's more than 80%. Okay, if you get an abdominal tumor, somebody might ask you, oh, what do you think is the survival for a stage 4 Wilms tumor? The only cancers which have survival less than 50% are metastatic rhabdomyosarcoma, metastatic osteosarcoma, and metastatic Ewing sarcoma. Even metastatic Ewings have, if they have good prognostic factors, may have an EFS of more than 50%. So survival is good. So next question they would ask is, how come pediatric cancers are doing better than adult cancers? What has led to this achievement? Every year we see new MABs, new TKIs, new immunotherapies coming in adult cancers, but the difference has not been much. Pediatric oncology is still cyclophosphamide, etoposide, vincristine, actinomycin D. It's very rarely you see immunotherapy or TKIs. So with these drugs, how did we achieve this? I'll come to that. With these drugs, so we have less mutation is not responsible for better action of cyclophosphamide, no. So how did it come out? Very common question asked by, if Dr. Sagar comes, he likes to ask this question. And the answer is very simple. Formation of cooperative groups, that's where you have BFM trials, you have the COG trials, now in India, the ICCL trials. So people started talking to each other. Clinical trials, every question, any cancer in children, that's simple. Is RT effective or not? Is dose dense effective or not? So over the decades, you kept on having trials, IRS 1, 2, 3, 4, then NWTS trials. So formation of clinical trials. Protocol-based treatment. Any kid treated anywhere in any part of the world will get the same treatment. So it's easy to analyze results. Funding. Obviously, the government, non-government organization helped in funding and research. So every clinical question was tagged to a basic science question. So anytime you take the current neuroblastoma trials, Wilms tumor trials, you see 11q deficiency or, you know, all those things are taken. So this is the wheel of success of pediatric oncology. So even without your immunotherapies and TKIs, we are able to achieve such good results. Another favorite question. If you have a child, they will ask, how are pediatric cancers different from adult cancers? So these are some of the points. Most of the pediatric cancers are aggressive histology, embryonal. That's why they respond very well to chemotherapy. Obviously, something, you know, divides faster, they are more prone for destruction. So majority of where you don't see low-grade lymphomas in children. You don't, very rare. You have only case reports of follicular lymphomas. So low-grade tumors are very rare. If they are low-grade, they tend to be some low-grade sarcomas. Okay. Similarly, in most of the lymphomas aggressive, if you have a child with a nodal swelling for 2 years, please don't go and say it's Burkitt's or non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. It's usually Hodgkin's. So only slow-growing lymphoma in a child, 2 years, coming and going, multiple biopsies, is usually a Hodgkin. You don't see a Burkitt's hanging around for 7-8 months. If it's not Hodgkin's, it has to be some other non-malignant condition. As I said, many respond to chemotherapy. Targeted therapy is not effective. As she said, why? Why does PD-L1 agents, nivolumab, there have been trials with nivo-ipi and all. Why don't they work? Dr. Ganeshan, has already. Mutation burden is less. So there was a recent paper in Nature 3 months back, which looked at the mutation burden in pediatric cancers versus adult cancers. There's a drastic difference. And as I said, the more the mutational burden, more neoantigens, more chance for immunotherapies, all those things to work. So number mutation burden is very less, neoantigens are very less. So immunotherapy has been a flop in pediatric cancers. Again, we don't know the etiology for most of the pediatric cancers, unlike adults. In adults, about 35 to 40% of cancers are environmental or lifestyle related. About 60 to 65% are because of pure bad luck or some unknown mutation. Here we don't know what causes us. Majority of the pediatric cancers are not hereditary. Common example is retinoblastoma. Okay. So we know that retinoblastoma is a hereditary. We say that 40% of retinoblastoma may be hereditary. But that doesn't mean that the parents also have retinoblastoma. In the clinic, we don't see that all the parents of retinoblastoma have hereditary. Only less than 10% are familial. So when you say it's hereditary, the first mutation occurs in the child. So he is the index case. So although high percentage of retinoblastoma is hereditary, only 10% are familial. Same is true for most of the pediatric, whether it's leukemias, lymphomas, neuroblastoma. The adults have a higher proportion of familial cancers than compared to pediatric cases. If that was the case, we would be screening all parents. We screen only retinoblastoma. We don't see leukemia patients. We don't screen parents or lymphoma patients or neuroblastoma patients. Okay. Again, site and cell of origin are not same. Very unusual to see carcinomas in children. Nasopharyngeal carcinoma would be commonest in adolescent. And even if you start seeing carcinomas, they usually occur in the teens and adolescent. In a young child, in an infant, or you know, a toddler, you don't see carcinomas. And you're bothered about long-term effects. When you're pushing in ABVD in a child, you're looking at 70 years of life ahead, rather than an ABVD in an adult. So you have, and the pediatric heart is much more sensitive to the anthracycline effects to an adult because it's a growing, organ. So you have to worry about radiation side effects. And the best part is, although Raji wanted me to cover the long-term side effect, I didn't have time. You have to understand that it takes decades for you to start seeing effect of radiation, anthracyclines. So you are looking at coronary artery disease, renal dysfunction, hearing deficits. And you have to understand that in 70s and 80s, pediatric cancer treatments were much more aggressive. You didn't have reduced radiation fields. You were using more anthracycline, higher dose alkylating agents. So over the years, as the survival is improved, you try to reduce the doses. So long-term effects are much more common in children when compared to adults, and better survival. So it's a huge. So you can keep on talking for 5 minutes to the examiner. What are the differences? Just tell them the points. This is commonly asked. And what are the common pediatric cancers? Again, leukemias and lymphomas are the most common. They constitute 40%. ALL is more common than, 4 times more common than AML in children, followed by brain tumors. And then it's easy to remember your sarcoma, rhabdomyosarcoma, osteosarcoma is about 15%. Neuroblastoma is 10%. Everything else is less than 5%. So if somebody wants to tell you what is the breakup of tumors in common pediatric cancers, this is the same. Treatment option is multimodality. We know majority of the pediatric cancers, apart from leukemias and lymphomas, are multimodality. Clinical presentation. In exam, you'll have only three clinical presentations. It's very simple. If you have an algorithm in your brain, it's very difficult to fail a pediatric case. Okay. So either you'll be given an abdominal mass, or you'll have a child with a soft tissue swelling or a bone swelling, or you'll have a proptosis. So it'll be clear. You will not get a child without any finding, you know, some respiratory, it's not like lung cancer, some bronchi, Krebs or bronchial breath sounds. So it will be blatantly visible. Okay, so you just have to tell what is there. So let's see what these three clinical scenarios we can face. The most commonest would be an abdominal mass. Any child who's just got admitted in the ward will be kept for the exam. Remember this table. Remember this differential diagnosis. Neuroblastoma, Wilms tumor, hepatoblastoma, lymphoma, germ cell tumor, RMS, P87. Okay. If you can't remember, at least remember the organ. Okay, liver is there, it can be hepatoblastoma. Kidney is there, it can be Wilms tumor. Retroperitoneum is there, it could be a sarcoma. Genitalia is there, it could be a germ cell tumor. Okay. And obviously lymph nodes are the lymphoma. But thing is, how do you put this in sequence for a differential diagnosis makes it important. And for that, the age of the child is very important. Okay, so if you have a child less than 5 years, your top three should be neuroblastoma, Wilms tumor, and hepatoblastoma. Don't go and tell in a 15-year-old child it's hepatoblastoma or a neuroblastoma. Understood? We have had. I'll tell you why. We had a child who was 12 years old who had neuroblastoma, kept in the exam. It got leaked that he's got neuroblastoma, and the first differential diagnosis given by the candidate was neuroblastoma. Obviously, the examiner will ask that the has been leaked. Even if it's neuroblastoma, I would never keep neuroblastoma as a differential diagnosis in a 12-year. I'll be safer with a lymphoma or a germ cell tumor or a sarcoma. Okay. So less than 5 years, neuroblastoma within septum, because very rare to see these embryonal tumors after that age. Lymphoma is also very unusual less than 5 years. You don't see, you know, Hodgkin's less than or in a NHL. So majority of the lymphomas are elderly children and adolescents. Germ cell tumor is bimodal. Okay, so infancy, usually sacrococcygeal teratoma or testicular tumors. You don't get young girls presenting with tumors in infancy. It's usually males, either a teratoma or a testicular tumor. And in adolescents, like in adults, you can both get testicular as well as ovarian tumors. Rhabdomyosarcoma and Ewing's can occur at any age. If you have this in your mind, it becomes easy. You will not panic. You have a mass. Okay, how old is this child? Okay, this is 10 years. Okay, unlikely to be Wilms, hepatoblastoma, neuroblastoma. My differential has to be a lymphoma or a germ cell tumor. Let me go in that way. This child is 2 years. Okay, where is the mass? Somewhere in the right hypochondrium. Could be hepato or neuro. I will proceed in that way. So remember this, because don't go and tell a different diagnosis. Don't go and tell 1 year has got Hodgkin's lymphoma and the abdominal mass. You might get leukemia. You may present hepatosplenomegaly, but presentation will be different. You know, only your pallor will be there, bleeding manifestation, the fever will be there. So keep it in mind. Second is proptosis. Again, a common spotter kept, unilateral or bilateral. Lot of students make mistake in proptosis. Okay, so these are the common differential diagnosis of proptosis. So when you have unilateral retinoblastomas, rhabdomyosarcomas, Ewing's, LCH and optic glioma. All the bilateral can also present as unilateral. Just because they're written bilateral doesn't mean that they can't be unilateral. Leukemias, neuroblastomas, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, retinoblastoma. For practical purpose in our clinical practice, if there is proptosis, most common diagnosis is leukemia. Myeloid sarcomas are the most common, followed by retinoblastomas and neuroblastomas. RMS can be kept, but they are not that common. But remember this differential diagnosis. If somebody asks what one test will you do, or two tests will you do to find out the diagnosis of proptosis? Okay, very good. First is peripheral smear. Don't go and say, I will do a biopsy. Okay, so do a peripheral smear. If you see blast, life becomes easy. Another test? Bone peripheral smear. Something simple, non-invasive. Torch light. Okay, the big mass protruding out. You are not able to put your torch. Get an imaging, MRI brain or a MRI orbiter. Thing is, you want to know if it is an intraocular or a Extraocular mass. What is the only intraocular mass in children? Retinoblastoma. Only intraocular malignancy in children is retinoblastoma. If you want to include adults, you can put in melanomas. But in children, it's retinoblastoma. So if it's an extraocular with no intraocular component, your retinoblastoma is also ruled out. Then you, all your sarcomas, LCH, everything come. So these are the two tests which will help you in narrowing your differential, whether it's extraocular or intraocular. Okay, any doubts in this? Swelling. So we have covered abdominal mass, we have covered proptosis. Next thing is a child with a swelling. Swelling is usually a bone tumor. Okay, most commonly an osteosarcoma or an Ewing sarcoma. Very rarely you might get a child with a lymphoma. Very, very rare. But usually is a bone tumor. Obviously, again, soft tissue sarcomas in a child is very rare. But if you get, it could be RMS or a non-abdominal soft tissue sarcomas. An important way to tell what it is to know what is the plane of the swelling. You notice that the candidates never tell us the plane of the swelling, because the plane of the swelling will give you an idea whether it's a muscle or it's a bone. Obviously, if it's fixed to the underlying bone, it's not mobile. You can confidently saying that it is arising from the bone, could be a bone tumor. If it's mobile, it's not fixed to the underlying bone, it has to be one of those sarcoma. You cannot say whether it's RMS or NRMS without doing a biopsy. So always mention the plane of the, it helps. You can have a soft tissue sarcoma which is attached to the underlying bone. But since it is, the bone is involved, you can still be confident that it is a bony, it could be a bony tumor. You don't know the histology. But a swelling has to be either a bone tumor or a sarcoma or a very rarely a lymphoma. So this will cover all your pediatrics. There is no mutation to read, there is no hi-fi stuff to read, it's just plain, practical, common sense. Before going to the exam, one day just sit quietly in a corner and mentally revise. If I get this case, what is the possibility? If I get proptosis, what could be? If I get a bony swelling? So that you will not struggle with your differential diagnosis. Okay. Again, if the swelling is in a much younger child, a 3-4 year child, sarcomas are more common than bone tumors. Bone tumors are more likely in adolescents and teenagers. Okay. Any doubts so far? Some other tips and tricks in children. Always examine the local site. You don't want a shrieking child. You are tense, the child is tense, you are not able, you are panicking, you are not able to examine. So if you have a bone tumor, directly go and examine. Don't start with general physical examination, CVS, RS, CNS, abdomen, and then by the time the child is crying, you are not sure. So if go directly to the target. Nobody is going to penalize you for not falling. In children, always go and check what is it. Okay. Look for always dysmorphism. When you are taking history, because again, Wilms tumor, rhabdomyosarcomas, all those things are associated with genetic, not, you know, dysmorphic conditions. So common, how do you look for dysmorphism? Whether eyes are all right, ears are all right, nose is all right, limb length is equal. So all those things, how is the fingers? How are the toes? How is the genitalia? Quick examination. So sir, I examined, there were no dysmorphic features. So what did you see? I looked at the eyes, I looked at the ears, I looked at the genitalia, I looked at the fingers, they're all looking normal. Okay, so obviously don't use the ECOG performance status. Okay, there's a separate status called Lansky. If you're not sure, if how you don't know how to remember the Lansky scale, you just say, sir, child is active and well and playing. I will go back, refer the Lansky scale and get back to her. Okay, I can't remember the Lansky scale. Okay, please don't do PV and PR. It's criminal, you'll go to jail, it's sexual assault. Okay, we have a candidate telling that I will do a per-rectal examination. Okay, please don't even mention that or don't even write that. You're not going to put a finger in the child. Okay, don't do that. And there are very few occasions when actually somebody ends up doing a PV in a child, PR in a child. It's only the place where somebody would do is a teratoma. Otherwise, there's no reason to go near the. You can do an external genital examination, but please do not say that I did not do a PV or PR. That means you wanted to do. It's not required, okay. And before any child, always say I will do a CBC before you put in a needle, because any swelling could be a leukemia or a stage 4 lymphoma. So always do that. History, make sure that you take a proper birth history. Immunization is important, because if somebody is 1 year old, you are going to start him on treatment, you need to know what he's been, you're not going to immunize him during that period. So birth history, immunization history is very important. Siblings, okay. So this has to be highlighted. And in the general physical examination, the nutritional status, For that, you need the height and weight. And anybody about 5 years, use the body mass index for age against the WHO charts. Anybody less than 5 years, weight for age against the WHO charts. Okay, any doubts here? Okay, confident. So I've just, kind of given you an overview of what is expected, what type of cases you will get, and this is what. Otherwise, it's very easy. If you just sit and read PISO, 3 days, 4 days, one chapter, each chapter is about 15 pages. You can cover, make notes, your pediatrics is covered. So I'll come to individual slides. If you want, you can take the slides. They are very extensive. I don't have time to cover, but we'll just skim through some of the important questions which might come in the exam. So you know Ewings, James Ewings, he was an American pathologist. If I'm correct, he's one of the founders of MSKCC. And obviously the second most common malignancy compared to, and these are the common differential diagnosis of all bone tumors, which I've already mentioned. The thing about Ewings is much more common in the appendicular skeleton, that is flat bones compared to your osteosarcoma. So this, you'll find out the common sites being the pelvis and ribs. Investigations, again, these are the common investigations which an orthopedician or an oncologist would use. But you have to remember that sometimes you might have to use two modalities, both CT and an MRI for a local part. Why? One person at a time, Yesharda. Yes. Yeah, and CT?
CT to know the extent of the lesion.
Yes, because if they have to plan for a prosthesis, it helps them to get measurements from a CT scanograms. Okay. Currently, it is recommended to do bone marrow for all patients with Ewing sarcoma. People would say that PET scan, if it doesn't show involvement, but it has not yet been validated or recommended. Many people would say PET scan is enough, but we still don't have the evidence like, Hodgkin's, where that PET scan uptake is equivalent to a negative bone marrow. Okay. So the most commonest mutation is the EWSFLI, T1122, but there are other more, about 10 to 15 translocations which can occur in Ewing sarcoma. So the prognostic factors for Ewing sarcoma and osteosarcoma are almost same. Age, very young age and very old age are poor prognostic factors. Tumor volume less than 200 ml. Okay. Response to the chemotherapy, necrosis, which is called as the Hubos grade. There are two more grades. There's one Italian, I can't remember the name. And obviously, presence, we don't clinically use this biochem markers and prognostic values currently. So the tumor volume, the necrosis, is used for the prognostication even in other bigger trials like Ewing. So if somebody has got a large tumor volume, has got a very poor response, that is necrosis is less than 90%, and if the margins are positive, these were the indications for giving radiotherapy, both in the German trials as well as the Eurowings. Okay, so currently majority of the Ewing's treatment is extrapolated from the Eurowing trial. I'll come to the trial. I'll come to this. So Eurowing, where is the? I think I missed the Eurowing trial. So Eurowing, as you say, had three groups. So we had the standard risk group, which went on to get the white chemotherapy. And then you had the that is intermediate risk group, which was the localized tumors, which were again divided between white, followed by continuing chemotherapy versus transplant, and the high risk group, which got all the transplants. So patients who had pulmonary only mets, who had a tumor volume more than 200 ml, were randomized between transplant and no transplant. You will be asked the results of Ewing. It's not yet been published. It's still in the abstract form. So patients who had lung metastasis did not benefit from transplant. Okay, it's just an abstract. We don't know. We have to get the journal. Who benefited from transplant? Patient who had localized high volume disease, that is more than 200 ml, non-metastatic. So patients who had localized disease benefited from transplant, whereas the patients who had lung mets did not benefit from transplant. And patients who had pelvic disease, benefited from radiotherapy, whereas patients who had chest wall disease did not benefit from radiotherapy. So these were the findings of the Eurowing trial. Also, there was no difference between VAC and VIE. That is, cyclophosphamide and ifosfamide could be interchanged. Easier to give cyclophosphamide than ifosfamide 5 days is a toxicity profile. Other things you can read these slides is that these are the major trials in Ewing's. Only two things you need to know. IE was not beneficial in patients with metastatic disease. On VAC was enough. IE addition was only helpful in patient localized disease. Another one is the dose dense chemotherapy, that is given every 2 weeks, that is VDC IE, was actually showed an 8 to 9% survival benefit when compared to your 3 weekly. So dose dense, this is again in localized disease, okay, not in metastatic. So in localized disease, dose dense chemotherapy was beneficial. In metastatic disease, IE is not beneficial. I've already spoken to you about the Eurowings, localized standard risk, localized high risk, metastatic to lung, and this the metastatic to other organs is not given. And this is the VAC, ifosfamide versus cyclophosphamide, high dose chemotherapy versus standard radiation. Okay. So any refractory is poor, commonly used agents are cyclophosphamide, topotecan, irinotecan, temozolomide. Outcomes are bad in refractory. Any doubts in Ewing's? So please read up about the Euro-Ewing results. Please read about the dose-dense chemotherapy, prognostic factors. These are the common things. And some of the things are overlapping between osteosarcomas and Ewing sarcomas. How do you do a biopsy? What are the investigations required? Okay. I will skip all these things. Staging, very important. There are two staging. We have the AJCC and the Enikin. Okay. I've covered this. Again, this is a very common question asked. Read the radiograph of a patient with osteosarcoma. So try to mention all those things. Osteoblastic, whether it's a new bone formation or osteolytic, whether there are sunray spicules, they are nothing but radial ossification. Huh? What is Codman's triangle? A lot of people struggle in Codman's triangle. So it's nothing but the rapid growth of growth leads to elevation of the periosteum, and there's not been no time for calcification to occur. And there can be a wide transition zone. Cortical breach or fractures are common. Comment on the adjacent soft tissue mass. Comment on the joint space. At least in children, the epiphysis acts as a natural barrier against the spread of the disease. Okay. So these are the common things. You can get a purely lytic lesion, mixed lytic sclerotic lesion, or a sclerotic lesion. Sharda has already said you need to get an MRI because you need to know the extent of the tumor into soft tissue and the medullary canal. You can get skips within the medullary canal, involvement of the joint, and crossing of the lesion across the epiphysis. Any skip lesions in the same bone, okay? Proximity or encasement of the neurovascular medulla, because when the surgeon is operating, he needs to know whether the vessels are involved. And obviously, we are looking at response to chemotherapy. These are the indications for doing an MRI. Another favorite question, what are the principles of biopsy? We all know that the surgeon who is operating should do the biopsy. Why? These are the reasons. One, biopsy should always be, so if somebody asks what are the principles of biopsy, always do after an imaging. If you have a large soft tissue mass, it's enough you go and take the biopsy from the soft tissue. You need not go directly and go to the bone. You will end up fracturing, causing a hematoma and making matters worse. You have to conserve planes. That's the principle of surgical oncology. Planes have to be conserved. Compartments have to be conserved. You remove the compartment. If you breach a compartment, contaminate the other compartment, you end up removing that also. So because of your foolishness, you might end up doing an amputation for a child who could have had a limb salvage. J needle biopsies are preferred, nothing but your standard, what you use for your bone medical oncology aspirations and biopsies. And as I said, get it from the involved tissue, you need not go. Please do not put a drain because you don't want to have seeding in the tract, and to be performed by the surgeon planning limb salvage and only through one muscle. So these are actually called the 7 or 8 commandments of doing a biopsy in osteosarcoma. So you will get brownie points for saying, sir, only one muscle has to go, drain should not be placed, scar should be longitudinal. Okay, so sample from the soft tissue. So this kind of tells you that you have in-depth knowledge of this subject. And next favorite question is, doctor, why do you give neoadjuvant chemotherapy? You have to remember that neoadjuvant chemotherapy does not offer a survival benefit. Then why do we still medical oncologists? Because we are medical oncologists, so we want to give chemotherapy? No. Obviously, you know, we see huge tumors in our clinics, you know, they would end up getting amputated. So you want to shrink the tumor, okay? Tumor necrosis is a prognostic factor. If you have good necrosis more than 90%, it means that you have a better chance of survival. But it's not a predictive factor. So I'll tell you, the Euromos trial, which is European and American osteosarcoma trial, the largest trial, which gave MAP, which is methotrexate, adriamycin, cisplatinum, and patients who did not have good response were randomized between addition of IE versus no IE. So addition of newer drugs actually did not improve survival. So there was no predictive value of necrosis. Similarly, in the patients who had good necrosis, they felt that there's an immune response, so they added interferon, pegylated interferon. That also did not show a benefit. So it was a negative trial, so nothing works. This is like your breast cancer. When you're looking, you know, triple negative, everybody gets, you know, we are looking at, we want to get full necrosis, pathological CRs. That's the basic inherent biology of the disease. The same patient you had operated and given chemotherapy would have done the same way. Okay, so that's the analogy I want to say. Because a lot of our surgical colleagues say, no, why don't you give chemotherapy in this operable tumor? Let him achieve path CR, his survival. It's not been proven so far in breast. It's the same. This is osteosarcoma analogy. And obviously, you want to buy time for prognosis. You operate somebody today, he's not going to get chemotherapy for another 4 to 6 weeks, wound healing. So you want to buy time for process, you want to delay the delivery of chemotherapy. Theoretically, you want to avoid micrometastasis, but if this was theoretical, then obviously it should have shown a survival benefit. So that's another favor. TNM is very important because T1, T2 size is very important, less than 8 centimeter, more than 8 centimeter. One of the few cancers where grading is part of the staging. Again, another favorite question, where else do you get grading as part of staging? Okay, in grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, grade 4. And nodes are very simple. Okay, and then, so as I said, this is the enicking, which is basically, again, extra compartmental versus intracompartmental, high grade versus low grade, mets there or not. Okay, so skip this. Another favorite question is, how do you classify osteosarcoma? So you have central osteosarcomas and surface osteosarcomas. Central osteosarcomas, majority of them are conventional, that is 75%, which is further divided into osteoblastic, chondroblastic, fibroblastic. Patients who have the osteoblastic respond better to chemotherapy than patients who have the chondroblastic. Then they have telangiectatic osteosarcomas. Again, how do they look on X-rays?
Light
lesions, okay. And small cell. How do you manage small cell osteosarcoma? They look like Ewing sarcoma. Huh? How do you treat them? Louder. You treat them like osteosarcoma. You don't end up treating like. So they have a morphology of small cells which is similar to Ewing's, but your management is similar to. They will have osteoid on them. Okay. The surface is nothing but periosteal and periosteal, and then you have extra osteous, that is soft tissue osteosarcoma. Again, a common question asked. Please note down, this is the common differential diagnosis of bone tumors. You can have a Jen cell tumor, aneurysmal bone cyst, Ewing's, osteoblastoma, secondary mets or lymphoma. Majority can be diagnosed by radiology. Okay. Diagnosis of osteosarcoma is a clinico radiological pathological diagnosis. All three have to be taken to make a diagnosis of a bone tumor. Current standard of care, we already said pre-treatment radiologic staining, biopsy to confirm preoperative chemotherapy, repeat radiological staging, surgical resection, reconstruction using one of the many techniques, and response based on post-op, which we don't know. Another favorite question, when do you amputate? The indications of amputations have shrunk over the decades. Very rarely, only time when you are amputated is when you have a dead limb. Okay, it's no use, there is no power, you can't use it, doesn't make any difference. vascular involvement or in some cases even neurological involvement is not a contraindication. You can do nerve transfers, you can get vascular grafts. Okay. Previously, pathological fractures were considered as a contraindication, no longer. Various studies have shown, give them neoadjuvant chemotherapy. If the fracture heals, you can go, outcomes are no different. So currently there's only, if the limb is dead, you cannot salvage it, that's the only indications. Okay. A large tumor in the pelvis also is not. You can always go and put a total femur replacement also and a total hip replacement in these patients. I've already told you about the uromos. Please read about one of the few randomized trials in osteosarcomas, a negative trial based on which I know all major decisions will be taken. Another thing which they commonly ask in osteosarcoma, which I haven't included, is that you have processes. So what are the different modalities of limb salvage in osteosarcoma? Who can answer? I've told you in rounds. Ashwin, what are the different modalities of limb salvage in osteosarcoma? Process. Okay, so one is process. What are processes made of?
Titan.
Why not stainless steel? We can, Ratna Stores can ask, make it for us, no? We give them, they'll make it for a cheaper. Why not?
Less reaction.
One is less biological reaction, okay. You can have metallosis. So you put stainless steel, you can actually have toxicity, cardiac, nephrotoxicity. It has happened and one company has got sued for it. Okay, then? Tensile strength, because titanium alloys are very strong. Put the amount of pressure on the knee and the leg is tremendous. So that's why the failure rates for your lower limb processes at 5 is almost 50%. Whereas in the shoulder, it's only 10%. So you have your upper limb processes last longer than your lower limb processes because imagine the sheer weight. So strength, metallosis. Okay, so these are two indications why you use titanium alloys. Okay, so one is this. What are the other options of limb salvage? First?
Autograft.
So where do you commonly take autografts? So fibula, sometimes the 11th or 12th rib. Okay. Then what else?
Allograft.
Allograft. What is bone banking? It's like some, just take a bone and keep there, cadaver. If that is the case, and all of us had anatomy bones, why weren't they used for this thing? It has to be harvested immediately and cryopreserved. Okay. What are the advantages of an allograft over a processes?
Remodeling.
Okay. One is remodeling. So why is that important, remodeling? Yeah, so you don't need to revise. If you put a processes in a child, you have to either have those fancy ones where you expand using a magnet, or you have to admit every 2 years, operate and expand. Okay, they are very costly. Whereas if an allograft picks up, it will grow along with the child, the bone will take shape, it's for life, you do not replace it. Obviously, it's much cheaper than a prosthesis. Okay, there is no danger for fracture or, you know, breaking of the prosthesis because the bone has become part of the your body. What are the disadvantages of an allograft?
More tiny.
Yes, non-union. So it will not, you try to stick it, you can't just stick it to the gum, it has to grow, vessels have to come. So sometimes these patients are in the bed for 6-7 months for waiting for union. And then?
Non-availability.
It can become available with more this thing, but as we said, biggest problem is non-union. Another major problem is processes, infections. It's a foreign body. Okay. So I didn't cover, but again, this is commonly asked in this thing. So let's go to Wilms tumor. You will have cases from Wilms tumor. One more.
Any issues with rejection?
Unlikely, because bone has very few immunologically active cells. You don't put somebody on immunosuppressive therapy.
Immediately,
it won't. Unlike the other organs, the immunogenicity of bone is very less. There are very few cells. You don't put them on cyclosporin or MMF. It's more of a non-union. You don't reject the bone. It's just, it just doesn't grow. It doesn't just fix with it. Okay, so there is no question of rejecting an allograft. You basically stripped it of all muscles and everything. Wilms tumor, Max Wilms, he was again a German pathologist and surgeon. So it's not a patient. A lot of people think that Max was the first patient with tumor. No, he was the pathologist. Okay. Common question, where is neoadjuvant chemotherapy, man? You all know, no? There are two groups, when the Americans and the Europeans, the SAOC and then the COG. Previously, it was the NWTS. Now it's been merged into Children's Oncology Group. So the Americans would give neoadjuvant chemotherapy if you have a solitary kidney, if you have bilateral Wilms tumor, if you have horseshoe kidney, if you have IVC thrombus extending above hepatic veins and unfit for surgery. Why would you give neoadjuvant in all these things? Why in bilateral Wilms tumor? Nephron spasming. You want to shrink the tumor and you want to, because you can't do bilateral nephrectomies. Why in horseshoe kidney?
Radiation.
Yes, you want to avoid radiation. Horseshoe is only one kidney. If you radiate the middle, you are lost. So you want to again downsize. You want to make it from a stage 3 to stage 2 so that you can avoid radiation. Why IVC thrombus above hepatic veins? Obviously, if something was hepatic veins, you'll have to have a cardiothoracic surgeon with you. You will have to get a bypass. You'll have to put on a heart-lung machine because it's going to the atrium. So you want to try, want to probably shrink it and avoid all these things. So above hepatic veins is above the liver. Okay. Obviously, unfit for surgery. So no situation where surgery is mandated. I've told you about the NWTS. Another question is, what are the advantages of neoadjuvant chemotherapy? It's there, but you can tell me now. What are the advantages? Most important advantage is tumor spill. Okay, look at this slide comparing the SAOP and NWTS. Where is the tumor spill complication? I don't know, missed this. 15% versus 2%. What happens when a tumor spill occurs? It upstages the tumor. It becomes stage 3. When it becomes stage 3, you have to give anthracyclines and radiation. You have to remember that even a small stage 1, 100 grams tumor, better to give neoadjuvant because the tumors are very friable. You will end up spilling a stage 1 also. But when you give neoadjuvant chemotherapy, they form a nice capsule and it comes out easily. So that is where, especially in developing countries or low middle income countries where facilities, surgical expertise, radiation facilities, toxicity is a big concern, neoadjuvant chemotherapy is preferable. Also, the margins, resection of other organs is less, so surgery is less extensive. You have almost 50% reduction in stage 3 tumors. Complications are much lesser. So, tumor downstaging, avoiding tumor spill, avoiding anthracycline and radiotherapy, avoiding resection of nearby organs, and avoiding decreased complication rates. Okay, so this is what as a tumor size does not predict. Okay, another important factor is if somebody got pulmonary mets upfront, you give neoadjuvant chemotherapy and the mets disappear, you can avoid lung radiation, which is what the current COG trial, which has been published, has shown. There, what they do is they do surgery. They give chemotherapy, and after 6 weeks, they dissipate. Now they're following the CO. They're not giving radiation. But that was also one of the bigger drawbacks. Okay. So I said 20 to 30% will get downstaged. Anthracycline RT is bad. Doxorubicin currently has shown not to be, the CO trials have shown that you don't need to give doxorubicin stage 3 intermediate risk. And lung mets I've already mentioned. What is the big counter criticism for neoadjuvant? So the previous CEOP trials were not recommending biopsies, okay, and there was about a 5% chance that you might end up getting something else, about 1.5 malignant disease and another 3.5 non-malignant condition. So the UK CCG, which is part of the CEOP, did a large trial and did a biopsy over 1,000 patients, and they clearly proved that biopsy before neoadjuvant chemotherapy, this is true cut, not an incisional biopsy, okay, not opening the abdomen, did not upstage the tumor. Okay, so in the COG, if you do a biopsy, the NWTS staging, it becomes stage 3. Whereas in the SEOP, if you do a biopsy, that is a true cut biopsy, it doesn't upstage it. Only an open incisional biopsy will upstage. The biggest problem with a biopsy is hemorrhage. So when you're doing a biopsy, always keep your surgeon on call, tell him that I'm taking this kid. Because in that 1,000 patient series, one patient had to be taken to the OT immediately because of hemoperitoneum. So that's the only risk. So currently, like in our center, we do a biopsy before giving neoadjuvant chemotherapy. And we have been surprised. We've got a lot of synovial sarcomas and Ewing sarcomas in patients. Okay. And another difference is the post-treatment classification. The histological classification in NWT is very straightforward. You operate, obviously you're staging, so you have the favorable histology and unfavorable. Unfavorable is mainly anaplasia. The clear cell and rhabdoid are now been taken out from the glims. They are managed differently. Whereas look at this swab, there are so many variables. You have the low-risk tumors, intermediate layer, you have epithelial, stromal, mixed, regressive, focal anaplasia, high risk is blastemal. Can somebody tell in SWOP, blastemal is high risk, in NWT it's favorable? Isn't it an oxymoron?
Which is not responding to
that. So if blastemal components are highly sensitive, they're like blastemal, that they are the primitive embryonal. So when you give chemotherapy, you expect them to disappear. So if you have persistent blastemal element in a patient after neoadjuvant chemotherapy, it makes it high risk. So that's why you have this dichotomy of a SWOP having blastemal as high risk and NWT is having it as favorable. Another criticism, this is what I've said. I've already mentioned to you about the misdiagnosis. This is the UK trial where, you know, there was no increased risk of recurrence. There was no needle track seeding, gain of one kill count. Another point I wanted to tell you was that another concern was that the pathology might get changed by neoadjuvant chemo. That's what the Americans felt. But the anaplasia will not change. Anaplasia will remain irrespective of your chemotherapy or no chemotherapy. It's only the other elements which will change. So currently, I am a big proponent of the SWOP protocol. As I said, I mentioned. So this is how your discussion will go. What is the difference between SWOP and NWTS? When do you give neoadjuvant chemotherapy? Why would you prefer? And all those things. Okay, 5 more minutes. Neuroblastoma, huge topic. Okay, one of the most confusing diseases. And I think I can talk whole day on neuroblastoma, but I'll try to condense it in 5 minutes just to. So I will just go. Diagnosis in a neuroblastoma. So main thing is staging. Okay. And the most important part is always get your CT, chest, abdomen, pelvis, and do a marrow. If the marrow is positive, you need not do a biopsy. With the corollary that you should have at least 40% cells in the marrow. Because if you want to do your genetic analysis, your NMIC amplification, you need adequate sample. Okay. And obviously, currently studies have shown that the question is MIBG versus PET scan versus bone scan. PET scans have been shown to be as equivalent as MIBG scans for both primary and your metastasis. Only problem with MIBGs is not easily available. It has to be outsourced from Bombay. So majority of us are doing PET scans. Okay. The question is, what is MIBG? MIBG is meta-iodobenzylguanidine. It is a norepinephrine analog, which is taken up by the your chromaffin cells and not metabolized. And obviously, it's tacked to a radioisotope, and you're picking it in a gamma camera. So these are all the diagnostic evaluations you will do. Clinical examination, urine VMA and HVA, they are byproducts of your dopamine metabolism, so they increased. You do an MRI, CT of the local part, tissue diagnosis, bone marrow. I've already spoken of MIBG and bone scan. NMIC is mandatory. It is important to remember that NMIC amplification is rare in early stages. It's less than 5% in early stages. As the stage increases, the NMIC, so it will be around 30% in stage 4. It's very rare in stage 1 and stage 2. So this is the pathway, tyrosine converts to DOPA. Some examiner may ask DOPA to dopamine, dopamine to norepinephrine and epinephrine. The pathway is blocked here in neuroblastoma. In pheochromocytoma, it is blocked here. That's why it's unusual to get hypertension in neuroblastoma. Okay, so whatever dopamine is released is immediately taken up by the cells. We read in physiology. So you don't get, whereas in pheochromocytoma, you get hypertension. If you get hypertension in neuroblastoma, it is usually because of the large mass compressing the renal artery. So it's usually a renal artery hypertension rather than a catecholamine induced hypertension. Again, if there is this thing, they will put up a scan, they'll ask you the difference between a neuroblastoma and a Wilms tumor. So calcifications are more common in neuroblastoma. Neuroblastoma has very infiltrative borders. It tends to go and stick to vessels. whereas Wilms tumor is a nice, soft, you know, easy, it comes out easily, whereas this tends to go and attack vessels. Lot of necrosis. So in a Wilms tumor, the vessel is pushed, whereas in a neuroblastoma, vessel is infiltrated. So all the calcification, you can see all the vessels are engulfed. Okay. And I'll not go through this. MIBG, I've already said, which is highly sensitive and specificity. This is where I was talking about the NMIC. You see NMIC amplification is quite low in the early stages, and on advanced stages increases, it goes up 30%. DNA ploidy is one more thing, which is only used another 2-3 minutes, only useful in infants. Big confusion in neuroblastoma is how do you stage them? So there are two classifications, INSS, International Neuroblastoma Staging System, which is a surgical classification, and the recent International Neuroblastoma Risk Grouping, INRG. INRG is a radiological classification. You can use either of them. Okay. And these classifications are highly complicated, but you have to just remember what is used to determine age. So age less than 1.5 years, more than 1.5 years, NMIC amplified, non-amplified. Third is histology, favorable, unfavorable, which is Shimada. So it depends on how much of neuronal differentiation. So more neuronal differentiation, more towards ganglioneuromas, better prognosis. Ploidy in younger children. So these are the things, and then you classify as low risk, intermediate risk, and high risk. This is for treatment. I will skip all those things. The INRG is again based on your radiological involvement of any vital organs, involvement of blood vessels, involvement of nerves, or extension beyond one cavity becomes a high risk. So it's called L1, L2, M. So it is resectable and non-resectable. So okay. You can use both. Screening has not found to be effective. Somebody may say, you know, you go and do a heel prick and look at VMS. The Japanese tried to do that. It costs a lot of money, and a lot of early stage neuroblastomas will actually regress without treatment. Now coming to the treatment part, as I said, there are three groups: low risk, intermediate risk, and high risk. So low risk, usually infants, NMIC non-amplified, early stage 1, stage 2, better off with your very rarely, you might have to give one or two cycles of chemotherapy, four drugs, cyclophosphamide, etoposide, carboplatin, azithromycin. Okay. Intermediate risk are the ones who are between stage 2, stage 3, or stage 4 without NMIC amplification. Again, they are further classified into favorable and unfavorable, depending on your histology. They generally require multimodality treatment. That is chemotherapy, either 4 to 8 cycles. If surgery is possible, do it surgery. You can leave the, if the mass is there and the surgeon says, I can't operate, don't go and touch it. We have patients with neuroblastoma stage 3 for 7 years, 10 years, 20 years who are going roaming around with a tumor, because most of these tumors are well differentiated after chemotherapy. And then you have the, you might add radiation. Again, this is very controversial. Another common problem which surgeons would say is, it starts off as a neuroblastoma, you give chemotherapy, they go and operate and say in high risk, it comes as ganglioneuroma. That doesn't mean that you will stop your treatment. That shows that the tumor has responded and differentiated. The prognosis doesn't change. Just because the neuroblastoma has become ganglioneuroma, you don't stop treating it. The risk is the same. High risk, the most controversial area, okay? So if somebody asks, how do you treat high risk neuroblastoma? I would first give induction chemotherapy. There are various regimes. You have the dose dense regime, like the rapid Kojak, and then you have the every 4 weekly regime, like CCG 3891. Currently, there is no evidence that dose-dense regimens are better than standard regimens. So in a country like India, because dose-dense give GCSF and don't wait for count recovery and keep on going. So it's very costly, increased mortality also. After that, after 5 or 6 cycles, reassess. If there's a good response, at least partial response, then plan for surgery. What is the role of surgery? If you're able to resect more than 90% of the primary, your survival outcomes are better. But any resection is better than no resection. You need not get an R0 resection. You can get away with R2 resection in neuroblastoma. That's the beauty of this tumor. It has some immunological mechanisms where you need not compromise on organs. You try to debulk as much as possible, and sometimes the tumor will disappear. Followed by autologous bone marrow transplant and 13-stage retinoic acid. The problem with autologous bone marrow transplants are the 3 trials, and the recent one by Catherine Mathe has been a negative trial. It has not shown a survival benefit. There's been only an EFS benefit with transplant. There's no overall survival benefit. The only modality which has shown survival benefit is immunotherapy with anti-GD1. So the survival with immunotherapy goes up to 70%, but unfortunately, it is not commercially available. Nobody wants to bring it commercially because it is not financially viable. Okay, so this is the basic schema for this thing. Another, I won't cover GCT. Another large trial recently published was comparing Bumel versus CM, that is carboplatin 2% melphalan, for as a conditioning regimen for autologous stem cell transplant, and Bumel has shown survival benefit. So it is the standard of care for conditioning regimen in neuroblastoma. I'm not covering because I've crossed time germ cell tumor, but in pediatric germ cell tumors, they'll ask for Altman classification, which is nothing but the sacrococcygeal teratoma, how much outside it is, 1, 2, 3, 4. Difference in staging between the adult and pediatric germ cell tumors, okay? So you have the COG staging, so which is quite different from the IGCCG staging, okay? Okay, so this is the staging and management. I'll give you the slides, you can go. When do you stake and what is the treatment of stage 1 testis, stage 2? Again, they might ask. Immature teratomas in children less than 15 years do not require chemotherapy, unlike adults. Isochromosome 12p is rare in children. Isochromosome 12p is seen more commonly in young adolescents, about 12 years. Okay. A germ cell tumor in a child more than 11 years is better managed than like an adult. There's only one dose of bleomycin. It's called Chota BEP or PEB. Okay, so only one day fixed dose, 10 units per meter square. And only in children, carboplatin has shown to be non-inferior to cisplatin, which is the JEB regimen. Okay, so I think you can read. I overshot my time, and these are all the unanswered questions in pediatric germ cell tumor. You can go through my slides. Any doubt? So obviously, we're not spoken about retinoblastoma. We're not spoken about non-rhabdomyosarcoma. So the brain tumors. So there's huge medulloblastoma is a sure shot question in the exam in theory, because with the newer all your classifications for medulloblastoma, your sonic hedgehog group 3, group 4, molecular classification, management of medulloblastoma. So please read up medulloblastomas. It will come every second or third year. This question will not come for your practicals, but theory question definitely will come. Rhabdomyosarcoma stratification will commonly come. What was the ASCO breaking abstract on RMS this year?
Maintenance.
Yes, so plenary. Maintenance improves in high-risk RMS, it improves survival. So soft tissues over, abdo. Retinoblastoma, how do you manage? Extraocular is common. How do you manage extraocular? When do you add radiation in extraocular retinoblastomas? What is the role of intraarterial chemotherapy in retinoblastoma? So I simply don't have time. We'll have to have one master class in pediatrics by Dr. Rajiv to cover all that. Leukemias and lymphomas we haven't covered. So we need a full day next time session in pediatrics. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Venkat. I think that was an exhaustive coverage over such a short period of time. Any cute questions we have? Because I think that pretty much covered the practical aspect. That's all I think you can tell and get away with a very good practical discussion. I think that has been very clarified presentation. No,
they're not desperate. They're desperate to go and have tea.
I think before tea, Nikita has some surprise for you. So we have a short presentation on some, it's an accuse. So now it's time for you. Since you have not asked questions, we thought we will ask you questions. So this will have one or two slides on that. And then we'll break for a cube tea.